we did a similar session in Bombay, very interesting discussions, and thanks to Pandey sir, last time it was an all women panel, okay, after handling the all women panel, everything else is easy because they're all high powered women and engaging with them is very challenging. Great. So let me just begin with a very real time experience that I recently had, because that will be very relevant for the topic that we're going to discuss. The other day I was taking an interview, and you know how the kids these days are, right? You take the interviews, and I was engaging with her, taking notes and asking her, saying that, you know, do you have any other questions? You know, the typical HR interview, do you have any other questions? She ends the interview by saying that, yes, I have a question. Generally, we expect that it would be about salary, or where is the job location, or whether you have a 5-day week, none of that. She says, what is the emphasis your organization puts on social impact? Least expected of a millennial, right? So I was a little taken aback, because I was honestly not prepared for such a comeback from a kid. Then I said, look, we do this. She said, but that's all corporate social responsibility. Do you really have an agenda at a firm level on what you do for social impact? Trust me, I was a little underprepared for that question. Then came the other surprise. Then I moved on. I went for a talent leadership meet, and the entire focus was, how do we take Deloitte outside of the organization and make it relevant to the societies that we're working in? And in fact, our global CEO, Pune Ranjan, has set an agenda that we need to be touching 30 million lives of girl children in the next 10 years, right? So these are the sort of conversations that are being propelled in organizations. And we are increasingly getting geared to understand the impact that it is creating. And we're realizing that most of the people who join us, the first thing that they do is engage with an NGO. What do you do over weekends? We go to that NGO to serve them or spend time with them. And we, in Deloitte, we do something called an Impact Day. Impact Day is a day when we actually inform our clients that we are not going to be serving client work today. We are going out and doing community service, right? So these sort of initiatives are increasingly becoming prevalent in Deloitte, and we are observing that the millennials who are joining us today are putting a lot of emphasis on that, and it's almost come to a stage where we are being forced at the executive talent leadership to say that, hey, look, unless we put a strong agenda and strongly commit to this, we're not going to cut it, because this is very important for us, and we truly believe that it is important. And that exactly is the relevance of the topic that we're going to be talking today, right? So going back to the challenges that we are all facing on how to adapt this social enterprise, there are three big elements that we are dealing with. You know, the three big design elements is, the discussions are revolving around what is the future of workforce. Gone are the days when people want to be tied to a particular organization over a period of time. They're saying that, can I do some part-time work with you because I'm good in this area and I would just want to spend some time with you and then go and do my MBA. Unheard of before, right? In fact, it has come to a stage where they choose whom to work with, forget me giving them an appointment later. So gone are the days, right? So, future of workforce, how do we engage with these people in a very constructive way, right? How do we take care of all the risk and regulatory compliances around how the information goes out and how do they engage with us? How do we retain their attention beyond a point in time? That is the future of workforce. So the second thing is the future of organization itself. How do teams work together? Recently, after a long time, Deloitte is an old organization, and obviously old organizations do come with a certain mind frame. And it was decided over a period of time, after a lot of push from millennials, in fact, we have 87% millennials working with us. The equation has changed now. Now we have completely given the flexibility to the millennials to work the day they want, the place they want, and the time they want. And if they want to work for 3 days, so be it. Right? So nobody wants to travel to the office. So this is disrupting the way leaders look at how to work with these people. Leaders are always used to people sitting in front of them, working and delivering jobs, right? So the leaders are trying to cope up with this change, and they're saying that, how do I deal with these people? And we go back and tell them, hey, you have Skype, you have this video conferences, you have these telephones, but the increasing resistance we face is that, I want this person in front of me. Now, forget the millennials. We're now training the leaders on how to deal with these millennials. So that's the sort of mind shift that we are seeing in our organization. And I'm sure a lot of you will identify with what I'm talking about, right? You must be facing similar challenges in the way you are looking at it. And the third and the most important part is, we are dealing with what is the future of HR in our organizations. How do we train our people to understand this change, right? What sort of questions to ask in the interview? We're all starting from there. You know, please don't ask the typical, tell me about yourself, you know, these sort of questions. And we're also telling them how to deal with these interviews and how do we look at this, how do we change these structures, how to change the governance. These are all the topics that we're dealing with currently, and we are actively involved in changing the way we look at the whole workforce completely, right? So this brings into another completely different dimension, the advent of technology. Now, if I have to engage with these millennials, these people are not going to be dealing with papers and mails. They need to have everything on their fingertips, right? So any launch that we do, for example, we launched a rewards and recognition platform. They're saying that, please don't ask us to go and log into the laptop. Give us something instant that we can press on the mobile and keep appreciating people, right? So there comes the difficulty of dealing with technology, right? And then we have this increasing emphasis on diversity. That's another side. Because what starts as a 50-50 person mix of women versus men completely drops to half by the time the women get promoted to become managers. And at that point in time in life, they further drop down, because by the time they reach the leadership level, we only have 12% of women left, right? These are all the challenges that we're facing in the context of this, looking at social enterprise and how to grapple with this problem, and how, what is the advent of technology. All these things are coming together, and that exactly is the basis of the discussion today, and we're going to be keeping it as engaging as possible. We have eminent panelists here. We were discussing yesterday and how to ensure that we give you all some good takeaways. So thanks for being here, and I look forward to a very engaging conversation with all our panelists. Bye.
I request Mr. Amit Kumar Das, Vice President HR, JSW Group. Then I request Mr. Alan Port, General Manager, IBM India Private Limited, to please join us on stage. I next invite Ms. Pornima Bhatish, Director and Co-Founder, experience of over 21 years. In her 16 years with the corporate sector, she has had an opportunity to work with leading companies like IBM, Airtel, Styria, and Godrej Industries. We are now request Dr. Pratima Shere, Director of Symbiosis Center for Management and HRD, to please take her seat on the dais. I invite Ms. Sharmila Bide, founder of HouseCast and CFO and co-founder of Calsoft Inc., to join us on the stage.
So what we're going to be discussing today, and I think the first thing is, for the uninitiated, we've been hearing about corporate social responsibility, and I'll start with you, Gunima. We've been hearing about corporate social responsibility, and slowly it has now shifted to building a social enterprise and how companies are rediscovering themselves. There are blurring lines, and if you could just give us a quick backdrop of what is CSR and how is it shifting and how are companies adapting to this, I think that would be a good segue to what we would discuss later.
Sure, thanks. Thanks for this opportunity and amazing to be on this PowerPoint panel. So I just want to go back to when I actually started my ventures. Incidentally, both of them are in the gender space. One of them is about enabling gender diversity and the other one is about enabling vendor diversity. And when we went to organizations to have conversations, and we started the conversations by saying, we want to enable both these pieces and it's about women. The first question that we got asked was, are you an NGO? So it starts from there. I think the impression that it's, you know, when you're doing something to empower someone, you need to be an NGO or a charitable institution or a trust. I think that's where the primary context of social enterprise lies with most of us who haven't had exposure to the other side of the game. And over the last 5 or 6 years is when I realized that the game is very different. CSR, social, NGOs, there's a whole lot of stuff happening in that space. And I think it's amazing that we're talking about this today because you know, I think I'm done with my pet peeve of always trying to tell people that no, I don't run an NGO because I'm not uplifting anybody from, you know, from a downtrodden space. We are trying to enable people, and those people happen to be educated women who need to be provided access to opportunities, and we're taking, you know, them up the ladder. So that's really where I think the lines, I would say.
So what you're essentially saying is that being profitable, earning revenue, yet being useful to communities around is going to be the theme moving forward. So it's no more one philanthropic activity where I would sponsor somebody's education, or it's much beyond that.
Absolutely.
Good. Thanks for that. So moving on to Amit. Amit, JSW, we've heard JSW's foray into various community programs, and to begin with, two questions for you. The first thing is, as JSW the giant, I'm sure you are actually training your HR teams and you're actually telling your leaders about this adapting change. That is number one. And number two, I would like to really understand what JSW is doing in the space further to what Purnima said and in the JSW context.
Thanks,
Vati.
Taking from where Purnima left, I think the entire word social enterprise, we need to see how it is different from a business which is generating revenue. Now, social enterprise, because the word social, when it gets added to enterprise, people have different connotations. And Purnima rightly said that, you know, the moment you talk about social enterprise, people think about NGO or some kind of CSR activity. But more importantly, social enterprises actually work on three fronts. You know, that's my understanding of it. One, how you are, along with your business revenue generation, impacting the environment and how you are adapting the technology. Now, the revenue, environment and technology, these are the three important aspects of a social enterprise. And their ask and their demands, the way they work is very different. So how do we ensure that there is a right balance depending on the businesses what we are into, and we are able to attract the right talent, which is a continuous challenge for HR, and we'll have to yet to track it in terms of, you know, how do we have the right mix for different businesses. Coming to your second question, there are a couple of enterprises which we have recently started, and I would like to share the example of JSW Paints. Many of you may not be aware that you know, we are now getting into paints business. We were in steel, we were in cement, and now we are getting into paints. We have launched in South, and when we were setting up that business, we were thinking of doing disruption in the industry. And coming straight to the HR side of it, we thought that, you know, if we are going to do disruption in the market, then we have certain strategies, and I'm not here to definitely sell JSW paints to all of you. But in terms of strategies, we said that our paints would be environment friendly. And we are not making any solvent-based paint. So the factory which we have set up in Vijayanagar, it is a first plant in the world which is completely water-based.
So low VOC, no solvent use, and it's an environment friendly plant. So that's one aspect of it, that's the environmental side of it. On the social side, we thought that we would be setting up our sales team across different geographies, and we decided to actually target young engineers from villages or rural areas, you know, where they were really finding it challenging to get a job, because, you know, they are neither getting selected in the top IT companies, nor they are getting the jobs which are core to their subject. So we decided to select engineers from these villages in the rural areas, and we decided to make them see the customer relationship officer, which is the frontline sales guy. So that's our social impact side of it.
So, Amit, the other question that I have for you is that how are communities taking this? You know, this whole sports initiative that you guys are running, how is the community reacting to it? As much as we are giving to the community, how is the community reacting to it, and what are you hearing back from the community?
That's a very interesting question. And, you know, having started my career in IR, especially in large business houses, and I've seen how communities earlier used to react to the corporates. And most of the time, it will start with a conflict, you know, be it, water getting polluted in the well, give us water connection along with your township, why can't we also have 24 hours of electricity? And it was always conflict. Though when the factories get set up, there is a lot of collaboration which you see from the community. But once the factories come up and they really become big and they start making money, I think there are a lot of demands, and you have to continuously balance between the community demand and what as an organization you can provide. And I'm sure many of the HR leaders sitting in this room, who have worked in a plant kind of environment, can support that claim. But I have seen that, more and more community work which is happening now is also changing how communities are reacting to it. And they are more becoming like partners. They are accepting you with open arms. So when you are setting up a factory, and the new law is that you have to take environment clearance, and you have to get all the villagers, and you have to get the consent signed. And we have been expanding, and I rarely find where there is any kind of opposition to that. That itself shows that the entire rural India is also gearing up for this. They want more and more industries to come. They know that when the industries come, they also do a lot of community work. So the reaction has been positive. So I can clearly see a paradigm shift in terms of how the communities used to react earlier and how they are doing it.
This Sharmila is also the CFO. I've written it that combining revenue growth and profit making with the need to respect and support its environment and stakeholder network, right? Where does this community service start, and where does it really face resistance from the stakeholders? And as a CFO, what are your observations when proposals come to you? On one side, we all know that we have to expand the social enterprise, and on the second side, you sign the checks. Right? So, where exactly do you step in, and where should we be stopping expanding the social enterprise?
Any finance people in the audience? On my side of the table?
Okay. Yeah.
So, seriously, I've been doing a lot of research and reading up on this topic over the last few months. And I have a completely different tangential view about social enterprise is what a typical company does today, and is it any different from this whole hype that has happened in the last couple of years, I think, since 2018. Companies, if they are run at the core value, the core of a company, if it's based on ethical practices and a kind of a win-win, I have this mantra of being always having a win-win relationship with each of your stakeholders, be it your employee, be it your vendor, be it your customer or your community, everyone. If I always ensure that I am I'm in this win-win relationship with them, my shareholder, and I am the shareholder of Kazakh, I will always benefit in the long run. And I'm just going to give you a simple example using numbers because that's what I'm good at, but imagine it on the HR side. If I'm negotiating with an employee and I try to get the squeeze out the best possible out of him. And I know his market value is 100, but I say, hey, you know what, I can get him down. I know he wants this job, let me get him at 90. That is profit maximization, right? Profit maximization is either you reduce cost, you increase your revenues. If I do that, sure, I will manage to save that 10 rupee for my shareholder, but that's for the short term. I know in a few months he's going to realize this is not his market value. He's going to be unhappy, he's not going to be productive, he's going to leave. And as HR people, I'm sure you know the cost of attrition, refilling, retraining out here. So this is not a long-term thing as a shareholder out here. Same with a client. If I try to shortchange, they pay me something, I try to do shortcuts, give him something less than what he's paid for. Sure, for that that contract, I will do it, I'll maybe make profits, but he's not going to come back to me. So essentially, I have to ensure that it's win-win, and that is what maximizes the shareholder value. It's a fundamental company policy philosophy. It is not these, as you said, someone comes up with a proposal or something. These are just bandages. I think fundamentally, your company needs to be run that way out here. And so I was just thinking about this hype that happened, and in 2019 August, there was a roundtable conference in New York where 200 top CEOs from Apple and Walmart and everyone came, and they made a pact that we are going to be socially, a social enterprise. We are going to look at these other, we'll worry about the employees and the vendors and everyone better. And that brought me to thinking that this is true for professionally managed CEOs whose lifespan as a CEO is typically 5 to 6 years. They need to report quarter-on-quarter earnings, and they need to deliver these numbers. They are not in this for the long run. They are not in this really that over 10 years, my company needs to get at that level. So for those, that's why it makes sense, even for the Deloitte report and everything, to focus the attention of these CEOs on the social enterprise aspect. I think as entrepreneurs or in Indian large companies, which are typically founder-driven out here, the long-term aspect is there in the heads out here, so they will do the right thing. You're not trying to shortchange anyone and make a quick buck. You're not going to last out there.
So moving on to Anand. Anand, you're from IBM, the technology giant. We've been hearing about the advent of disruption in technology. How do we get these people ready for the skills of the future? How is IBM looking at it, and how is IBM tackling this in the advent of all the social enterprise and the technology coming into play? How do you connect the dots there in IBM?
Sure, folks, good evening.
Good evening.
Goodness. That traffic impacted you so much that you are half here and half still on the road. So please come back in this room. Badri, thank you for that question. I'm not going to answer the skills question from the employee perspective. I'm going to answer the skills question from the social enterprise perspective. And our purpose of the organization is to be essential. And it's a very simple statement, because you can be essential to yourself, you'll be essential to the community, you'll be essential to your client, you'll be essential to your own life purpose which you have, you're dealing with. And examples always go well with the audience like this, because they have all the gain, and we'll just, give the examples so that they can connect within their ecosystem. So call for code is one example I want to share with you, which was introduced in 2019. The whole intent here was that people have to come up with a solution which will work, technology solution, which will work in the natural disaster scenario. And 5,000 employees worked on this particular initiative, came up with 250 ideas. Three of such ideas were shortlisted. And the two ideas have originally wanted to solve something. All of you remember that the tragedy which we had in Uttarakhand, the natural disaster. And here the solution, technology-led solution, which has been developed by our folks, is that let's say a human being is stuck in between the stones or the trees and stuff like that because of the earthquake or the cloud burst. A drone which will be hovering around the impacted area, because in the hills it's very difficult even for the volunteers to reach, and it will try and sense the particular types of sounds and other aspects to identify that there is potentially someone is stuck in this area, send that communication back to the team who can reach out. Also create the pictures and the other data sets to determine, is it worthwhile sending a human help or is it worthwhile sending like a Red Cross drone with the first aid and some of those aspects. You use the real-time intelligence in determining and you know taking those decisions and activating the subsystems to go out and help. Now, I think this is a good example of what social enterprise is trying to do. Second example.
Sense of pride in them that they were a part of a bigger purpose. You know,
right.
That's exactly what we're trying to say. And that's where organizations are leading to today. And even the youngsters today, it's not just about a job. They're also saying that, give me a little more than just a job that you're giving me. You know? Give me that purpose. And everybody's talking about it.
All of us being here after a day job on Friday evening speaks about that they want to, you know, explore something more than what they have done for the last 8 hours.
So these are such basic issues that they don't want to go there. You know, one of the things that therefore, and I think I should mention it here, that Symbiosis is doing as part of its ISR bees is in the catchment of about 22, 23 villages and around the university campus in Lovely. Every year, Symbiosis is sponsoring 4 girls teams, okay, to do either BCA or BSCIT or nursing or the medical technology graduation courses. They have to be from those villages and they have to have, you know, written their 12th standard exam and passed. And then we get them to, the main campus office. They stay in the hostel because the parents said, we will not send our girls every day, how they will commute. So they come and stay there, their tuition, their food, their board, their clothing, we look after everything. And that we've been doing for now 4 years.
Point of view over here, right? It's about like Sharmila said, that it's always the belief, the purpose behind it. When we make groups, all right, and we say we have to be inclusive, we actually make them exclusive. And that is another challenge. Because when I say, okay, this is an all-women's group, we have excluded everybody else out. Just an example. And again, why again focus on the women? And that was a point that actually also came up in the discussion, where you said men would like flexible working. Why are millennials a problem? They're not. They could not be. Why do you want to solve it? Why is HR always running, I have to solve this problem now? Don't solve it, leave it. Then manage. You have rules, you have policies, you have structures set in the organization. If they are okay to swing by those, they will be there. If they are not, they are not cut out of their organization. So just leave them alone. Why do we want to create independent platforms for people to say, okay, this is specially for you, you are going to do this? Keep it common. And that is going to be a much more inclusive environment. That is going to be more social as an organization as you can get, rather than trying to create a different sector and then trying to solve it again and again and again. That's all.
Yeah, I just want to respond to that. I don't think it's a question. I think, you, like you said, you've just narrated your perspective. I just have one thing to say. This is a classic debate of exclusion and inclusion. Unfortunately, if things were all inclusive by default, we wouldn't have any of these situations, whether it's economic exclusions, whether it is gender, whether it is societal, whether it is, you know, there are other forms. Politics and religion is what we don't want to get into in this debate. But unfortunately, if things happen by themselves, it we wouldn't really need to discuss anything. But what happens is, when a certain segment of the society, either caste, creed, gender, whatever the reason, whatever it is, gets excluded because of certain biases, unconscious biases that we carry along because we've grown in a certain way, that's where you need to start challenging situations, and that's where sometimes you need to give extra impetus to a certain constituency to make them equal, and after that it's a level playing field. But if you say that today, you know, football or let's say cricket, what kind of a sport is it? Is it an elitist sport? Is it, you know, people across the country? How does the last person on the ground in one rural place who's never seen the TV come here? In fact, I'll give you a classic example. When my daughter used to, you know, see the Indian women's cricket on team, she was asking my husband and me, she said, why are these girls not dancing? Why are they playing cricket? Where is Virat Kohli? And she had to be told there is a women's cricket team. Now the problem is, and you know, that's a simple statement which I think I've learned, what you can't see, you can't be. Which is why we need to create some role models to push the envelope. And I think the agenda of all of us is getting to equal, whatever it is, whether it's social, environmental, gender, economics. But unfortunately, we are not there. I think that's the only perspective that I wanted to
bring. I agree with you, just one point on this, right?
We have a very pleasant surprise, and I need Akhil ji and Dhanan ji for unveiling this surprise. So if I can request you to come here.
Thanks. NHRD to the young leaders here. We have identified 8 young leaders who have, you know, come forward and want to volunteer to support NHRD and support the HR fraternity here. And both of you have helped us doing that. Our institutional partners like SCNHRD, SIMS, the right talent to, you know, take this. And we thought, we're talking about social enterprise, you know, there is no other example than trying to showcase something which is taking shape in front of your eyes, sir. So next poetry, man, please add that as well. So thank you, Monica. A team who has been identified, can you please come over? Monica, Karima, Sudesh. Avniti,
say that it is your chapter, because whatever we've been doing is the confidence that we gain from you people. Aap logo ka support hai, saath hai, to isliye hum himmat kar lete hain. Aur ek himmat ye aur ki hai, that on the 4th of March, we have been given the responsibility by our head office to to organize a national level L&D summit. This is purely focusing on L&D. And there are a couple of topics. I will not share all the details because that will be a surprise, and wait for the next